Hello, people. Let us look at peritonsillar abscess. It is also called as Quincy. Okay. Basically, look at this. This is showing peritonsillar abscess on the left side and the uvula is pushed to the other side. Okay. So basically this, when somebody has chronic tonsillitis as a complication, they can develop this peritonsillar abscess. Okay. So, the squincy, actually the literal meaning is strangle, something like that, okay, in some other languages. So, what are we looking at today? Peritonsillar abscess, squincy, it is a complication of chronic tonsillitis. Tonsillitis, if you have long time, then you will develop peritonsillar abscess. Which tonsillitis are they talking about? The palatine tonsils, right? Now, look at this, in the neck, head and neck space infections, important spaces are there and their infection. So, we are talking about that so many spaces are there. In that, one of them is peritonsillar space. So, where is this peritonsillar space if you want to see? See, this is the mouth and here you have the tonsil, right? So, lateral to that tonsil, you can see beyond the fibrous capsule and the superior constrictor. So, between these two, between what and what there? Superior constrictor muscle and the fibrous capsule of the tonsil, middle, whatever you are seeing, that is the peritonsillar space. Okay, so what is the extent of the, what is the extent of this peritonsillar space? It is between the superior constrictor muscle and the fibrous capsule on the lateral aspect of tonsil. So where is this the peritonsillar space? This peritonsillar space is lateral to the tonsil. The source of infection for this peritonsillar space will be the tonsils. So infection of the tonsillar crypt will chronic inflammation as a complication, what will happen? You will develop peritonsillar space abscess, okay, or Quincy. So, the crypts of this tonsils are, crypts of these tonsils get infected and then as a complication, peritonsillar space abscess. So, what is peritonsillar space abscess called as? It is called as Quincy. How will you define peritonsillar abscess or Quincy? It is collection of pus in the peritonsillar space which lies between the capsule of the tonsil and the superior constrictor muscle. Very good. So, why does this happen? Causes peritonsillar abscess. We told you it is a complication of tonsillitis. So, it follows acute tonsillitis also. So, it's not just chronic tonsillitis. So, what happens is this tonsil will be there, right? The crypta magna will get infected, right? And then it gets sealed off. So, it will form an intratonsillar abscess which bursts through the tonsillar capsule to the to set up peritonsillitis and then an abscess. So, this abscess will be the peritonsillar abscess or Quincy, okay? So, which are the organisms? You have to name some organisms now. Always throat. Think about throat. Streptococcus pyogenes. Okay. And always with streptococcus, put in some staphylococcus and blame them also. Sometimes it can be anaerobic organisms also. Okay. Clinical features. What do you think will happen if this peritonsillar space abscess happens? See, acute tonsillitis is common in children, but peritonsillar abscess is common in adults. Why? They didn't say why. It's easy to go from tonsils to peritonsillar space in adults, is it? No idea, but it says it is more in adults and it is unilateral condition. Okay, so only one side at least it's affecting. Bilateral also they have recorded. Fine. So, clinical features, they are telling you general features. General features, what will be there, guys? General features. You say somebody has an infection of the tonsils. Now, the peritonsillar space also got affected. What general features will be there? Fever, guys, chills, rigors, general malaise, body aches, headache, nausea, constipation, mainly remember femur. They will have this bacteria in them, pus and infection. So, they will have fever, chills, rigors, etc. Okay. Any acute infection like that only it will be. Local. Local what and all will you see? Severe pain in throat. These people will have pain in throat. Obviously, they have a mass there. What do you say? An inflammation, infection there, they cannot swallow. Odynophagia. Odynophagia is what? Odynophagia means painful swallowing. So, these people cannot swallow their own saliva, okay, and that dribbles from the angle of mouth. And patient is usually dehydrated. Why? He cannot swallow anything, right? So, he will be dehydrated. So, this is also important word, okay? then this how this person will talk, you know, they will talk with a hot potato voice. So where will you see hot potato voice? Very important. Hot potato voice you will see in Quincy. Hot potato voice. Potato voice. Hot potato voice. Where will see? In Quincy, that is peritonsillar abscess. Foul breath will be there. Because of sepsis of oral cavity, they will have foul breath. And also they wouldn't have maintained hygiene because they cannot brush, swallow and all that. Right? Ipsilateral side earache. Earache, they will have same side. This is because via which the cranial nerve 9, glossopharyngeal. So in referred otalgia, you have read this. Remember, in referred otalgia, you've seen that you can have ear pain, same side, because of what? Because of glossopharyngeal nerve. Here, see, they're showing here. Because of this glossopharyngeal nerve, peritonsillar abscess, Quincy, you can have ear pain. Okay? Usually on same side you will have. If you have your tonsils, peritonsillar abscess on your right side, then you have right ear pain. Okay? Ipsilateral. And this is because of which nerve? Glossopharyngeal nerve. Okay? Trismus can be there. That is lockjaw. Why? Because the pterygoid muscles are, which are in close proximity with the superior constrictor, they become spasmed. So why will they have trismus? That also you should write. You can't just write trismus and leave. They will have trismus because of the pterygoid muscles, right? Spasm of pterygoid muscles. Where are these pterygoid muscles? Let us see. So here, you can see the medial pterygoid muscle. Okay, anything else you can see? So because of the pterygoid muscles, which is this other muscle here? Okay, so because of this pterygoid muscle, you will have trismus. So can you say the clinical features of Quincy, the local ones? Hot potato voice, they cannot swallow, odynophagia, even their own saliva, they can't swallow. So their saliva will be dribbling from the angle of mouth. And then what else you saw? They'll be dehydrated because they cannot swallow, drink water. They'll have foul smell. And also they wouldn't have maintained hygiene, right? And then, what else, people? Hot potato voice. Did I forget hot potato voice? Ipsilateral earache, trismus. All these are important. Okay, people? So, what did we see in clinical features? General, we saw they'll have fever, malaise, etc. Local, we saw ear pain. So, now the features are over. General and these are the symptoms. General and local symptoms are over. Differential, you should know that you should be able to differentiate it from carcinoma of the tonsil. So, this is lymphoma. You can see right tonsil presenting as unilateral tonsillar enlargement. So, this is right. So, right tonsil lymphoma is there. It is presenting as a unilateral tonsillar enlargement. Okay, but here the uvula doesn't seem to be pushed, right? Anyways. So, differentiated from what? You should be able to differentiate peritonsillar abscess from what?
Lymphoma from peritonsillar abscess.
Thank you. So, you should differentiate lymphoma and peritonsillar abscess Quincy. Okay. So, now let us move on to the examination of peritonsillar abscess. What will you see in examination when you are examining a peritonsillar abscess, guys? So, what will you see? The peritonsillar abscess here is on the left side. So, what is happening to the uvula? It is pushed to the right side. And how is it? It's all looking swollen, congested, right? So, the tonsil, pillars and soft palate on the involved side. On the involved side, they look congested and swollen. The tonsil itself may not appear enlarged. Okay. But it is buried in edematous pillars. The tonsil itself doesn't look enlarged, but it is buried in edematous pillars. The uvula is swollen, edematous and pushed to the opposite side. Bulging of the soft palate and anterior pillar above the tonsil. So you will see that there is bulging of the soft palate and the anterior pillar above the tonsil. Mucopus. So you will see mucopus may be seen covering the tonsillar region. So can you see pus or something here? Mucopus. Cervical lymphadenopathy is commonly seen. This involves which one? Gigulodigastric lymph nodes. So obviously it's an infection. So the lymph nodes can be involved. Cervical lymph nodes and cervical lymphadenopathy. And what else are they saying here? Especially the gigulodigastric lymph nodes can be involved. Jugulodigastric is which which ring it is. See here, jugular digastric. So all these tonsils are draining here around the jugular vein. Look at this. Jugular vein shown here, right? So around it, it is draining from the tonsil. So obviously, the jugular digastric lymph nodes can be enlarged. Kind of makes sense, right? Torticollis, patient keeps the neck tilted to once to the side of the abscess. To the side of the abscess only he will tilt his head. Considering that this photo they are showing left side, then we will show like this. She is also tilting the neck to the side of the abscess. So, as such clinical examination when you do, you should see all this redness, congestion, uvula pushed to the contralateral side, then mucopus, then what else did you see guys? The tonsils is embedded in the, it is buried in the edematous pillars. Then the soft palate bulged anterior pillar above the tonsil. Then cervical lymphadenopathy which involves jugular digastric lymph nodes can be involved. Torticollis will be there. Patient will keep their head, neck tilted to the side of the abscess. Did we miss anything? So basically your job was to differentiate from carcinoma. You know the features of peritonsillar abscess. So you should be able to differentiate, right? What investigation will you order here? If you order by chance CT or MRI, you will see the abscess. And its extent also you can see. Needle aspiration of the abscess provides material for culture and sensitivity for the bacteria. See, if you are able to get the contents, then you can do culture and sensitivity. So, how will you treat this condition, guys? You hospitalize this person, give them IV fluids to combat dehydration, right? Because they are not able to eat anything, right? So, you give them intravenous fluids. Antibiotics you will give. What antibiotics will you give? Suitable antibiotics in large IV doses. So, they are giving IV because they cannot orally take it. Okay, that kind of makes sense. See, this is important here. You will write a lot of things in exam, but you will forget that antibiotics, how you should give. Because here, the person cannot swallow. You will have to give IV antibiotics, right? And you will have to give the antibiotics in such a way that you cover both aerobic and anaerobic organisms. Okay, then you will give analgesics like paracetamol for relief from pain and also to reduce their fever, right? And sometimes stronger analgesics like pethidine you can give. See, pethidine is coming under opioid analgesics. See here, you have pethidine. Synthetic opioid it is. Like tramadol. So, you can give pethidine. Okay. So, what is pethidine? Pethidine is opioid analgesic. So, if you want, you can give this if there is too much pain looks like. Okay. Upload. Opioid. Have you written the correct spelling? Opioids. Yeah. Aspirin is also avoided because of the danger of bleeding. So something we have to write, keep in mind that don't give aspirin. Aspirin is avoided. Very important. Remember this, okay? Aspirin is avoided. Here they are suggesting some saline mouthwash because I think the person anyways doesn't have to swallow, right? Mouthwash means. And then, these are all the conservative methods. This itself may cure the peritonsillitis. But if it doesn't get cured by this antibiotic, IV fluids to combat dehydration, paracetamol, pethidine, aspirin is avoided, saline mouthwash, all this, if it doesn't work, what will you do? Incision and drainage, guys. Anyways, this incision and drainage for peritonsillar abscess forceps, this they don't use anymore. If frank abscess has formed, incision and drainage will be required. Now, what is frank abscess? Any abscess that is clinically evident becomes frank abscess. So, if it has formed abscess, you can just incise and drain it. In the exam, you have to draw this diagram, guys. So, you draw this peritonsillar abscess pushing this uvula to the contralateral side and you draw one line like this and draw one line like this. Okay. So, this is a line along the anterior pillar. Oops. This is the line along the anterior pillar and this is the horizontal line through the base of the uvula. Lateral to this junction here, you will have to make the incision and drainage. Okay. So, there are two options they are giving. This is not the only one. What they are saying is, wherever there is maximum bulge, no, above the upper pole of tonsils, either there you can do the incision and drainage what we will do, just lateral to the junction of these two lines. Which two lines? Anterior pillar and the base of uvula. You will draw two lines and lateral to that junction, you will make the incision and drainage, okay, with the guarded knife. So, what are they using? Actually, they're just using a guarded knife and a small stab incision is made and then a sinus forceps is inserted to open the abscess. So whatever you saw, this anal is old, no need this. Okay, so they're just using a guarded knife, sinus forceps, to insert in and open the abscess. Putting the sinus forceps the following day may also be necessary to drain any reaccumulation. So not only one day, next day also they are putting the sinus forceps into that incision and draining. Okay, if there's reaccumulation, so next day also, the following day also, you have to go and get this done. Okay, so you'll do incision and drainage of abscess for what? Peritonsillar abscess. You should remember the sites of incision: maximum bulge or the lateral to the point of the junction between the junction of what? The anterior pillar of the tonsil and the base of the uvula. And following day also, you'll have to put the sinus forceps inside and drain any reaccumulation. Next we are coming to tonsillectomy, guys. So what and all they did, first of all, they gave conservative treatment with antibiotics and etc. Then they did incision drainage. Now that also leads, now they've come to tonsillectomy. Tonsillectomy means what? After some 6 to 4 weeks following an attack of Quincy, they want to do tonsillectomy. They want to remove the tonsils. Abscess or hot tonsillectomy, that is, instead of draining and all that, they are just directly doing hot tonsillectomy. But this looks scary to me. How will they do this? They have to remove the tonsils, even though there is this pus in the sitting in the peritonsillar space, is it? Abscess tonsillectomy has the risk of rupture of the abscess during anesthesia and excessive bleeding at the time of operation. So it has the risk of rupture and bleeding, excessive bleeding, but anyways, they're giving anesthesia. So did you get tonsillectomy, guys? So they're removing the tonsils itself. Look at the absolute indications for tonsillectomy. Peritonsillar abscess in children, like 4 to 6 weeks after the abscess has been treated, they want to do this. In adults, if there is a second attack of peritonsillar abscess, then only they are doing all this. Okay. One attack in adults, they don't care. This one is the photo. Tonsil being dissected from its bed, they are cutting the pedicle at the lower pole of the tonsil being cut with snare. Okay. So, how will you do tonsillectomy? Hot methods are there and cold methods are there. Just now you saw hot tonsillectomy also they can do, right? Using laser, radio frequency, electrocautery, etc. Cold methods, how will you do? There are so many methods here. Scalpel method and etc. You will have to look at these. Dissection and snare, most common. This is the photo that you saw, right, with the snare. So based on the marks, you can elaborate on tonsillectomy. Okay, let's move on. So this is the tonsillectomy position. That looks scary, right? Note Drafin's bipods holding Boyle-Davis mouth gag. So the Boyle-Davis mouth gag is being held by this Drafin's bipod. Levin is Boyle-Davis mouth gag with three sizes of tongue blades. Where is this Levin? Here. This is the Boyle-Davis mouth gag. Okay, then you need those bipods. Where are those bipods? Here they didn't show the bipods. Here they didn't show the bipods. Okay. Okay, guys, let's move on. What will happen if you let this peritonsillar abscess sit? Right, it can go into parapharyngeal space and create parapharyngeal space abscess. So where are we? Here we have the infection here, peritonsillar space. So this is your mouth, and from here, or this is, yeah, it's your oropharynx, you can see, right? From here it can go to parapharyngeal space. This is your parapharyngeal space. So there can be parapharyngeal space abscess, right? Then edema of larynx can happen. So imagine it just goes inside down and it causes edema of larynx. This is very dangerous. That time you will have to have tracheostomy. So tracheostomy, remember, if the person has laryngeal edema, that means they cannot breathe, right? So whenever there is respiratory obstruction, then you'll have to, one of the indication for tracheostomy is respiratory obstruction. Focus, guys. Septicemia can happen just like any other infection, pneumonitis or lung abscess. Now it went even further down and it has caused pneumonitis, lung abscess. Okay. Jugular vein thrombosis. Now you know that it was draining around the jugular vein. So jugular vein thrombosis has been written here. Spontaneous hemorrhage also can happen from carotid artery or jugular vein, because you see it is around these structures, right? So it's possible that there can be स्पॉन्टेनियस हेमरेज फ्रॉम कैरोटिड आर्टरी और जुगुलर वेन. सो ट्रेकियोस्टोमी इंडिकेशंस, वन ऑफ देम यू कैन सी हियर, इट्स रिटन एज पेरिटॉन्सिलर एब्सेस. दैट इज ओनली इफ देयर इज लैरिंजियल एडिमा बिकॉज ऑफ दिस, राइट? ओके, सो लेट्स टेक अ रीकैप गाइस. व्हाट डिड वी सी इन दिस वीडियो? In this video, we wanted to look at peritonsillar abscess. It's also called as Quincy. Basically, Quincy means a strangle in other languages. Complication, it is a complication of tonsillitis, okay? And this is peritonsillar abscess on the left side that you're seeing. You can see how there is congestion, etc. And the uvula is pushed to the contralateral side. So basically, it is an peritonsillar space is an important space of the head and neck. And from where to where is it? It is from the lateral wall of the tonsil, lateral fibrous capsule of the tonsil till the superior constrictor. Between these two, you have the peritonsillar space. Okay. And what else you should know here? So, there's going to be collection of pus in this area. That is what will cause this peritonsillar abscess or Quincy. So, why does this happen? Once somebody has tonsillitis, the crypta magna can get infected and then it can get sealed off. So, intratonsillar abscess bursts through the tonsillar capsule and then it enters this peritonsillar space, right? Peritonsillitis it can cause and then abscess. So, the causative organisms are Streptococcus, pyogenes, Staphylococcus, sometimes even anaerobic organisms. So, you will have to give treatment for both aerobic and anaerobic. Usually, this is seen in adults, though acute tonsillitis is more in children. This peritonsillar abscess is actually seen in adults. It's unilateral, though it can be bilateral, okay? So, these people, how will they present? Fever, malaise, septicemia, body ache, okay? And local, you can see that these people have severe pain in the throat, hot potato voice, odynophagia, they cannot swallow. So, they will, saliva will be dribbling from their angle of mouth. They will be dehydrated because they cannot swallow. They will have a hot potato voice, which is actually a thick speech, muffled and thick speech. They'll have foul breath because of all this bacteria in the oral cavity and poor hygiene. And ipsilateral earache they will have with this because of glossopharyngeal nerve, same side ear pain. Trismus they will have because of the spasm of the pterygoid muscles, which are very close to the superior constrictor muscle, that lockjaw. Trismus means. So here you can see that because of this peritonsillar abscess, so the person will have ear pain via the glossopharyngeal nerve. That is the referred otalgia. Differential is like lymphoma. Be careful. You should not confuse with lymphoma. And what else? You will examine. When you examine, what will you see? That there is congested and swollen. All these areas are congested and swollen. The tonsil itself is not enlarged, but it can be buried within the edematous pillars. Uvula is swollen. Edematous pushed to the opposite side. Then mucopus, you can see. Then there can be cervical lymphadenopathy. Jugulodigastric lymph nodes can be involved. Torticollis, the patient keeps the neck tilted to the side of the abscess. Okay. So, you can do CT, MRI, you want to see the abscess and the extent of the abscess, you can do this. And you can take some pus to do culture and sensitivity. Treatment, you will hospitalize the patient. Intravenous fluid, you will give for combating dehydration. Antibiotics, you can give IV doses because this person cannot swallow, right? So, you will give antibiotics such a way as to you want to attack both aerobic and anaerobic organisms. You can give paracetamol for pain relief and to lower the temperature. If required, you can give pethidine, that is opioid analgesic, which is stronger analgesic. Aspirin should be avoided, guys. And then you should give them the saline mouthwash or with hydrogen peroxide. They won't swallow it. They'll just do a mouthwash. So, all this should be able to tackle this peritonsillar abscess. If it is not going away, then they will, if it is possible, they'll do incision and drainage. So, if frank abscess is there, then maximum bulge over the upper pole of tonsil, they will just incise and drain. Or they can go via these two lines. See, they draw a line along the anterior pillar of the tonsil and along the base of the uvula. And here, lateral to this junction, you can make the incision using this what knife? Guarded knife. And then you will use the sinus forceps and drain it. And following day also, next day also, you would put the sinus forceps and look for any reaccumulation and drain that. Okay. Otherwise, next step, you have tonsillectomy. So, tonsillectomy, you can do interval tonsillectomy. So, that is the word interval tonsillectomy, which seems better, isn't it? So, they will remove the tonsils 4 to 6 weeks following the attack of Quincy in children. or you can in adults, if there are two attacks of peritonsillar abscess, then you can that's an indication for tonsillectomy. There is something else called as a hot abscess tonsillectomy. That is, this person, they won't do any incision drainage. They will take the remove the tonsil along with the content, right, the pus, etc. So, but there is a risk of rupture of the abscess during anesthesia, and excessive bleeding also can happen, right? This bleeding we also saw somewhere, right? Excessive bleeding. That's why you should not give aspirin in these people, they said. Yeah. Don't give aspirin for treatment. That is why they said, right? Because there can be excessive bleeding. Kind of makes sense now. So, tonsillectomy they are showing here, guys. This is the dissection and snare, most common type of tonsillectomy. You can see here, they are dissecting the tonsil from its bed. See, they are dissecting it from its bed, and then the pedicle at the lower pole of the tonsil is being cut with a snare. So, dissection and snare is the most common method of tonsillectomy. So, you got the indication, absolute indication of for tonsillectomy. This is one of the absolute indications for tonsillectomy, that is peritonsillar abscess. This is the tonsillectomy position. So, here they have used a Boyle Davis mouth gag, and they have put a Draffin's bipod which is holding this mouth gag. So, guys, these are the instruments used for tonsillectomy. So, if you don't treat, what will happen? Parapharyngeal abscess can happen. You saw where the parapharyngeal space is. Edema of larynx, if it happens, you'll have to do tracheostomy. Septicemia can be there, and other complications. It can go so bad that endocarditis, nephritis, brain abscess, what and all. And if it goes down, lung abscess, pneumonitis, jugular vein thrombosis, and spontaneous hemorrhage can happen from the carotid artery or jugular vein. That you can see here, the jugular vein and carotid artery, where they are placed in reference to this peritonsillar space, right? And it drains around the jugular vein, right? The lymph nodes. Look at this. Cavernous sinus thrombosis can happen because of peritonsillar abscess via the pharyngeal plexus. So, even cavernous sinus thrombosis they have written here. Okay. Next, guys, this is the indication for tracheostomy. We told you if there is laryngeal edema in the complication, then tracheostomy is an indication. That's it, guys. We have completed peritonsillar abscess Quincy. Bye-bye.